From Yahoo Finance, this is Ballots and Dollars, a podcast about the politics that affect your pocketbook. I'm Rick Newman.
And I'm Alexis Christophorus. And today we are talking about the recent U.S.-China trade deal and what it might mean for the 2020 election. And Rick, we know that trade was one of the focal points of the president's candidacy. The fact that he now seems to have a deal in principle with China and even a deal in principle with Mexico and Canada to replace NAFTA, could Trump at least check those boxes and say, look, success come voting time?
I think he could. But before we get to the details, we have a special guest today, Alex. You're not going to believe it. To discuss all of this with us is
yes,
President Trump himself.
What?
And he has a button.
Can I press it?
Go for it.
Basically, all I've done is keep my promise.
Oh, how apropos for our conversation today.
I actually didn't know that when you push that button, that he was going to say that.
No, I wouldn't have guessed it either with the many, many other things he says that are very memorable.
That would be completely fitting what the doll just said.
Yes.
What the Trump doll just said. Yeah,
he's already claiming victory, but I guess should he be claiming victory?
I think he's going to claim victory. I told you I was going to get a great deal with China, and it's even better than I thought it was going to be. It's the best trade deal we've ever had. I'm sure that's what he's going to say. I think what we'll be talking about is it any kind of deal really at all? And I think there are a lot of similarities to other things we talk about a lot with Trump. So the biggest part of this deal for markets is that it prevents something bad from happening. So this prevents a big set of new tariffs going into effect that was going to hit in December of this year, and that would have hit a lot of electronics that come from China, smartphones, laptops, things like that. And that would have been visible to American consumers. And I mean, a lot of us thought there's no way Trump would ever do that, basically raise the cost of an iPhone by 10% or 15%, and a lot of other products that are kind of high visibility like that. So because of the deal, the phase one deal, at least something bad is not going to happen. So that's not – Trump will not be shooting himself in the foot during the campaign by having to explain higher taxes and higher prices on consumers. But is anything actually going to happen that's good from this deal that he'll be able, that you know voters will actually be able to see in 2020? I don't think so, but I think we're pretty sure that Trump is going to be telling voters that whatever they see happening around them that's good, it's all because of this trade deal he made with China. So to that extent, I think Trump, it's better than nothing from his perspective.
Now, Trump has delayed or canceled tariffs four times this year, just in 2019
right.
alone. And you have to wonder here, who really is winning? Because you've got China hanging tough, leaving the Trump administration to basically negotiate with itself in many
yep.
ways. So is China the one really getting the better deal here?
You know, let's go back and just summarize everything that has happened in this trade war so far. So because any normal American can be excused for having lost track of all of this a long time ago.
Right.
So where we stand, and this could be the way it is for a while. This could just sort of be the end state for a while. Mm-hmm. So last year, Trump imposed new tariffs on about $250 billion worth of Chinese imports. That's about half of everything China imports to the United States. Those were mostly components and what are known as intermediate goods that go into other things built here in the United States. So not end state consumer products, not finished clothing or laptops or toys or sporting goods, but components that manufacturers here use to put into stuff. Those tariffs remain in effect. And from what we can tell, those are going to stay there probably through at least most of 2020, unless Trump kind of changes his mind on that. And then this year, Trump imposed tariffs on about $110 billion worth of what are consumer products that come from China. So that was a lot of clothing, some toys, a lot of things that actually show up in stores. And as part of this so-called phase one trade deal, that tariff gets reduced from 15%, which is what Trump set it at on September 1st, and it's now going to be just 7.5%. So all told, there are still considerably higher tariffs on most of the stuff that comes here from China. And those are going to stay in effect. So what do we gain from those higher tariffs? I mean, nothing. We gain nothing. And somebody here in the United States has to pay those higher tariffs. So Trump keeps saying the Chinese pay those tariffs. That is not true at all. Americans pay those tariffs. So This phase
and, you know,
one
Chinese export
trade
prices
deal.
Didn't even fall. So you do have to wonder right. who really is paying for these things, and is it not the American taxpayer?
Well, I mean, there's no single answer. So when somebody raised their prices, what happens? I mean, just think, if somebody raises their price by 10% at a store, what do? Well, you might buy it anyway. You might go looking around to see if you can get it someplace else for cheaper. You might buy something else that's a little cheaper but not exactly the same. You might just skip it altogether. And I think that's what companies here in the United States are doing. They're doing all of those things, the importers who are paying these tariffs. So in some cases, they're probably going back to the Chinese suppliers and saying, I'm taking a 10% or a 15%. In some cases, 25%. The tariff is 25%. I'm taking a 25% cost hit here. You have to share this with me. And so maybe they lower the price. We also know that some companies are trying to find stuff outside of China in places like India or Vietnam or Mexico, where there are no tariffs. But that tariff, those tariffs that are still there, are just not doing anything at all for the United
States.
Isn't
China in and of itself reducing its reliance on America?
Yes.
They're forging partnerships with other countries.
Yep.
And so you have to wonder—
And developing more of their own technology.
And also what I want to know, which we're not knowing as at the time of this podcast— is what are the concessions the Chinese are making for the U.S. as part of this phase one trade deal? I mean, what in that trade deal will secure the intellectual property of U.S. companies doing business in China?
So Trump says, and his trade guy, Robert Lighthizer, who's the U.S. trade representative, they have a long list of these general things that China is going to do. And if you could create a wish list of how you want China to fix its economy, this is what you would put on it. So they're going to change the way they deal with intellectual property. That means stealing Western technology. They're going to reform, have all these internal reforms, better rule of law. They're going to stop subsidizing the big companies that go out and take market share by underpricing everybody, that kind of stuff. But there's no one has seen an actual draft of this deal yet. And I mean, there's vast skepticism that China is actually going to do all these things. So we know that China had said that as part of any changes it was willing to make, it wanted all the tariffs rolled back. And mm-hmm. and Trump barely rolled back the tariffs. So I did the numbers. And in terms of the total new tariff burden on all these Chinese imports, that one tariff rollback adds up to about 11% of the total new tariff that is rolling back. So almost all the tariffs Trump has put on stay there. So I just don't think China is going to change much in exchange for Trump rolling back the tariff burden 11%. But
also,
we all know that what's probably going to happen here is China is going to say it's going to do these things, and then it's going to do the bare minimum and wait and see, does Trump get elected again? Do they have to deal with him for another 4 years? Or are they maybe going to get somebody else come in who's not necessarily going to support these Trump terms?
What we do know from this trade deal is it seems awfully agriculture-focused. And it's still yet to be seen whether or not farmers will like this deal and whether or not they're going to get any relief. I know Trump tweeted out, farmers are going to have to go out and buy much larger tractors because it means a lot of business.
No farmers are rushing out and buying bigger tractors. I am sure of that.
Yeah. So they don't seem very pleased with this. I mean, at the end of the day, it's just you know, the Chinese at buying what they were buying even before the trade war had started.
Right. That's why the trade experts following all this are so skeptical, because we have a long way to go just to get back to the point where farmers recoup lost sales, because China's basically been boycotting a lot of their products and no longer buying much in the way of soybeans or pork or other things that they used to buy a lot of from the United States. So I think at the peak in maybe 2017, if I recall right, China bought about $25 billion worth of U.S. farm products. And that has fallen to like 10 billion. So we got a long way to go just to get back to where we were. And now they're saying they're going to essentially double the amount of farm products and other types of products over some period of time. That sounds like it's not 1 year, but it's not 5 years, so maybe it's 2 years. And there are tons of questions about this. So number one, do the Chinese mean it? And they've been sort of tight-lipped about this. Most of the verbiage on this has come from the United States saying this is what China plans to do, but we have not really heard China saying, yes, that's correct, that's what we plan to do. And I think that is probably the way it's going to go. So China is, you know—
You don't think we get a big photo op with Xi Jinping
no,
and President Trump?
In fact, What we learned when they announced this deal is there is going to be no big meeting, no summit meeting, if you will, between the two presidents, Trump and Xi. It's going to be their underlings at the cabinet level who are going to meet and make this deal probably at the beginning of 2020. And that could be because the Chinese don't want their president Xi just doesn't want to be seen making this deal with Trump. The Chinese are spinning this too, and there's reason to think that the Chinese view this as a pretty good deal for themselves because they may be able to say they're going to do one thing to the United States but play it differently at home and not really change that much. In other words, there's not really much of a cost to anybody in China from this.
And if you look at what the pundits are saying, not many of them are backing President Trump's claims that this is a victory. You've got Paul Krugman, who is an opinion columnist over at the New York Times. Mm-hmm. And perhaps this is not a surprise coming from him, but he's tweeting out, Trump tried to bully them, the Chinese. They hung tough and are basically ending up where they started, buying agricultural products while selling us increasingly sophisticated manufactured goods. So what does this mean for economic ties between the U.S. and Beijing going forward, beyond the signing of this deal, if it happens?
Yeah, I think the days of easy trade between the U.S. and China are over. And I think that might be a good thing. It might not be a good thing. And you always have to think, what are the unintended consequences of this going to be? One of them probably will be that China will become more independent. It will need the United States less. I mean, one of the things we've seen with regard to Huawei, the big Chinese telecom firm, is we saw very clearly this year that Huawei has been – I almost said Yahweh. I probably have a Christmas pageant on my mind or something. Is that Huawei is very dependent on American chip suppliers. And the Trump administration has been holding that up and saying, oh, we might not let you buy chips from these U.S. companies, which you vitally need. Well, China is going to develop its own chips. I mean, almost surely. They're already going in that direction, and it's a matter of sophistication, I believe. But they're going to, you know, so this could spur them to develop something that's very important to economic supremacy in the
future. Push them to innovation.
And they develop their own capability on this. So,
you know what's ironic, though, Rick, is that the chip stocks have been on fire throughout this entire U.S.-China trade war.
Partly because markets have thought all along that this is going to get resolved. I've been saying for a long time that markets have been too optimistic about a breakthrough here. I think that applies to chips as well. I think as we get deep into the 2020 election, by which I mean summer and fall of next year, mm-hmm. I think this China trade deal is going to be like so many other things in the Trump presidency, is people are going to see in it what they want to see in it.
The way they do with immigration?
The way they do with impeachment is the one that's on my mind. But if you're a Trump supporter, you believe what he said. You believe Trump when he says it's a witch hunt and it's a hoax. If you're a Trump critic, you can't wait for him to get impeached, and you think it should have happened 3 years ago. And there are just not that many people in the middle who aren't sure, and they're waiting to see what the evidence is. There are some people in the middle on these issues, but it's a small group. And I think that Trump is definitely going to be talking about the trade war when he's campaigning. He's going to be saying. He likes people to think he's tough on China, and he's going to be saying, I was the first president who ever got tough with China, and look at the great deal I made. And I think people are going to look around and say, is the economy good around me or is it crappy around me? And if it's good, then I'll credit Trump with a great trade deal. And if the economy's crappy around me, then maybe these other critics are right, that this trade deal really did more harm than good.
He's got an unemployment rate at a half-century low.
Right. So
he's got a stock market at a record high.
This is yet another way in which it really all comes back to the state of the economy in September and October of 2020.
And certainly a lot of things can change between now and then. I want to talk about the other trade deal here, right? The replacement for NAFTA, the United States-Mexico-Canada agreement, which is still pending. I mean, they say they have a deal in principle, hasn't been signed yet. Now, as of this podcast, there was talk that the U.S. wants to send sort of labor overseers yeah. over to Mexico to say, we want to make sure that the labor reforms you promised are actually happening. And Mexico saying, wait a minute, we are not going to agree to that. Do you think that Trump will be able to at least say,
let's see what
Fox
he said.
And friends in the morning, they're very honorable people.
I thought he was going to repeat that he makes promises and keeps them.
You never
them.
Know what this Trump is going to say.
But the real life one, too. But
like
can he
Trump.
At least claim victory with USMCA?
Trump can claim victory on anything.
Is it a true victory?
I mean, he's going to claim victory on impeachment. He's going to claim that somehow this worked out better than if we had Hillary Clinton and, you know, that's why we should give him another 4 years. Sure, he will claim victory, and we've already seen the rhetoric. You know, this great trade deal, you know, no other president had the courage to blah, blah, blah. The new, let's call it the new NAFTA. Nobody knows what
right,
it's
the
called
NAFTA.
The USMCA, but let's call it the new NAFTA. It changes the old NAFTA in some
incremental
modest
way.
Ways.
Okay.
And there's kind of a surprising outcome here because it turns out the Democrats were able to get more labor protections into the deal than the Trump team negotiated in the first place, which has actually made some Republicans in Congress uncomfortable about Trump's trade deal. I mean, it's kind of amazing. But so you mentioned the ability of the United States to send inspectors into Mexican companies
right.
to see, are you really enforcing the labor standards that that the deal says have to be in place? So that's what Nancy Pelosi, the House Speaker, and her allies, that's what they wanted to get in the deal. And they were doing that because organized labor here in the United States was pushing them to do that. So obviously, long-time allies, the Democrats and organized labor. And this went further than I think a lot of Republicans ever thought was going to happen, which Nancy Pelosi can claim as a victory. And Trump, it's weird because that's fine with Trump,
mm-hmm.
but it goes against Republican orthodoxy, which is – you know, the easiest access to labor you can possibly get, the easiest, the loosest limits on wages and stuff like that. That's not what this deal does. So one of the most significant changes from the old NAFTA is the way it tightens up labor rules, which mostly applies to Mexico because the U.S. and Canadian economies are very similar. The Mexican economy is different. It's still a developing economy. Wage is much lower. Their internal protections for workers much less than we have here in the United States. So to prevent automakers and other manufacturers from just building everything in Mexico where pay is lower and you know, work standards are lower, there has to be this minimum – they have to meet this minimum level of work standards and wages. And the – final deal, it sounds like, is going to be – there's going to be sort of a third-party arbitration panel that will do inspections, so it won't just be Americans popping in unannounced. I mean, no sovereign country would be happy about that or even allow it. So it's reasonable for Mexico to say, no, we're not doing that. But third party, so that labor groups here in the United States will for sure monitor – who's complying with the law in Mexico and who they think is not complying with it. And when those suspicious companies, they're going to ask for inspections. And, you know, what the organized labor here in the United States wants to make sure happens is that we just don't lose any more jobs to Mexico. So that is part of the deal that is meant to protect American workers. So Trump did campaign on this. He did not sound like a traditional Republican even when he was campaigning, because all of this is very protectionist. And Republicans, you know, the rest of the Republican establishment just kind of has to go along with Trump at this point.
It's America first.
So
that's his trade policy.
It's real policy is Trump first. Republicans just have no choice but to go along with these because they're so tied to Trump at this point. Oppose Trump.
I loved one of your recent articles because you pointed out, with the help of some other folks here at Yahoo Finance, that Trump has exaggerated or fabricated about the trade war dozens of times. You guys came up with some sort of a number. So, you know, at some point, when is it the boy who cried wolf?
Well,
because you know what? The
always.
Markets – can I tell you something? The markets did not have the sort of aggressive, positive response you might have thought they would have had when word finally came down that this phase one trade deal was, quote unquote, done.
Right.
Because we're wondering now, are investors also saying, you know what? We don't believe it till we see it.
This is work that was done by Ben Werschkel of Yahoo Finance and also Sarah Painter. They actually went through several hundred transcripts of Trump interviews and briefings and remarks to the press and his rallies to see what he actually said about trade. And he exaggerates about trade constantly. And the reason we did this was to because of the way the markets react to every rumor or everything Trump says about something that's about to happen in a China trade. We've seen it all year.
Mm-hmm.
Trump says, oh, we're close to a deal, which he has said more than three dozen times in 2019. We're close to
three
a deal.
Three dozen.
And we only got a phase one trade deal on, what was it, December
13th?
13th, right, Friday the 13th.
Right.
He said it in January. He said in January we're close to a deal. He said it in February. He said it in March. We're always close to a deal. And what was actually happening while Trump was saying we're close to a deal is they were we were actually escalating. I mean, he was actually raising tariffs already in place and adding more tariffs.
Is it a way to artificially send the stock market higher?
It's a great question because it did.
It absolutely did.
Send the stock market higher.
All you have to do is look at charts. And the minute a tweet like that came out,
I mean, we cover it every
rally.
Day, right?
Right?
Oh, the market just jumped. What happened? Oh, Trump's tweeted.
Do you want to know what we do in the newsroom?
About China.
Now? The first thing we do is I go to his Twitter feed. Did he tweet something that's market moving recently?
Yeah, and he does, frankly,
yep.
And
There's
he doesn't usually. Personally say something that sends the markets down, but then markets have to figure out, reading the body language
right.
Or what is the White House not saying, or, Bloomberg or the Wall Street Journal is reporting a breakdown in talks because they get that off the record from negotiators or whatever.
Mm.
So, markets have been just jittery really for the last almost 2 years on trade. And so we put together just how many times has Trump basically misspoken or lied on trade. And all told, going back to January, Trump in one way or another expressed optimism that, the trade talks were going well more than 150 times.
Wow.
And they were actually going – even when they were going worse, not better, he said they were going fine. So now we have a so-called phase one trade deal, which is the second time Trump announced it. He first mm-hmm. announced it on October 11th. And then again, we actually had the deal on December 13th, but we still don't know what's in the deal. And I mean, some people are just saying, is there even a deal?
You know what? When we thought we were close to that trade one deal, he actually tweeted out, we're not close. And that did bring the market lower. So there are moments when that does happen.
You're right. And so he does that because that's his way of snapping back at
mm-hmm.
the Chinese.
Right.
He's like, oh, they're the ones who want a deal.
But at the
I'm
end
not
of
ready.
The day, is President Trump a prisoner of the U.S. stock market? Meaning if he were to see this market really start to crumble, especially as we move closer to November next year when we all go to the polls, does he very quickly snap back, as you say?
I think if the Trump market, if the stock market goes down considerably, which I would say 10% or more, then Trump is a prisoner of the stock market. But probably so is any president.
Mm.
And if the stock market stays steady or goes up, he's not a prisoner of the stock market. He's been very lucky so far. I mean, he's had good stock. The stock market has done well under him. But again, I think the China trade deal is the kind of thing that will be something people either give him credit or blame for next year, depending on how
Which
well the
on?
Overall economy is going.
Okay.
So,
fair enough.
If the economy sort of stays around where it is right now, which is good enough for Trump, then I think voters, by and large, will give him credit for a China trade deal. If it deteriorates in some way, if voters start to see layoffs, especially if manufacturing gets worse, we have a very soft manufacturing sector right now, in part because of the tariffs, then I think Trump's going to get blamed for a trade deal. And from my own metric is to go back to what the stated purpose of this trade war with China in the first place. The stated purpose was to bring jobs back to America. That is not happening, and nobody thinks it's going to happen by 2020 or probably ever.
We do hear about the occasional automaker saying, okay, we're going to open up another plant here. We're not going to make the car in Mexico or overseas the way we had said we were going to. That counts for something, though, Rick.
It does, but we've now had a downturn in manufacturing employment for the last few months. And if you look at manufacturing employment, look at it over 10 years, for example. It goes up at the beginning of Trump's term, but then it starts to come down again. And it's probably up just a little bit for his presidency as a whole, which is exactly how it was before his presidency. So very few voters are ever going to go to the Bureau of Labor Statistics webpage and right before they vote and say, oh, I want to see how many manufacturing jobs have actually materialized. I mean, we'll be telling them. They might take a glance at an article.
But you're saying
or something.
Don't take the president at his word because we know that he lies.
I never take the president at his word.
Listen,
and I don't know. I have arguments all the time with people who do.
Now,
including audience members.
The economist, Stephen Moore, again, maybe not a surprise to the folks who know Stephen Moore, said that last week was the best week so far of President Trump's presidency
mm-hmm.
because of the deals he brokered with both Mexico, Canada, and the U.S. While others are saying, but you know what? He created problems where perhaps there were none. I mean, I think a lot of people would agree that something had to be done with China, that it was not an equitable deal with China for many decades. So, did he create something make a mess out of it, and then say, but look, I just fixed the problem I made.
My metaphor for this is an arsonist who lights a fire and then claims credit for putting it out. And Trump has done a lot of that. He has sort of put out fires that he started or partially put them out and tried to claim credit for it. So you refer to Steve Moore. He's a Trump ally. He's one of the guys Trump considered appointing to the Federal Reserve. So he's in Trump's corner. I think he's right that Trump, politically, it's a win for him to get these two trade deals. But all of the economists I follow and the forecasting firms that I follow, they are basically all saying the same thing about both of these deals, the one with Canada and Mexico and the whether we have a deal even with China. It's just not going to change very much. I mean, here is a good example. This is Capital Economics, which is a good forecasting firm, writing in mid-December. The phase one trade deal, apparently agreed with China, is a small positive for the outlook to the extent it removes the threat of further tariffs. But we doubt the rollback of existing tariffs or the promise of China ramping up purchase of U.S. goods will provide anything more than a modest boost to the economy. That's basically what all the economists are saying. You know, if we'll be surprised if we even see it in the numbers. And for that even to happen, China has to do what Trump says they're going to do, which is these big increases in farm purchases. They have to do it for Trump. They have to do it in 2020. It's no good for him if they do it in 2021. He needs the votes at the end of 2020. Right. So, and these things also don't turn on a dime. You don't just turn this on and off. I mean, China's buying farm products from somebody else right now, from Brazil. So, and, you know, you don't just grow food out of the ground on short notice, you know? So you have to have the products to sell. So, I think a bigger question is what's the direction of the overall economy, because that's what people are going to associate with these two trade deals, whether they think these trade deals are good or not.
All right, we're going to have Mr. Trump have the last word today.
From this day forward, it's going to be only America first.
Got that?
Yeah, that's his trade policy. All right, Rick Newman, thank you as always for being with us. Thank you all for listening. Be sure to rate and review what you just heard and follow me at Alexis TV News.
And me at Rick J. Newman.
Thanks for listening.
Bye.